Good morning. I'll join Professor Sabri in welcoming you to IIM Bangalore. I think he was quite generous in introducing me. I am a humble professor here, and I have been in IIM Bangalore for about 12 years now. And the one part I agree with is that I do evangelize free software, open source a lot. That is the non-academic part of me. The academic part of me looks at it very objectively, which is what I will do today. I promise that. We also have a second keynote speaker, which is Mishi Chaudhary right here, and I will introduce her. So I want to make sure that the billing is right. So I'll try to speak for about half an hour, and then bring on Mishi, and then we can have some Q&A if you so want. Otherwise, we do have a very exciting panel after this, and then we can carry the questions over to the panel. Now, I will be saying a few academic things in my talk. Go over some FOSS basics, something about FOSS economics, something about FOSS and strategy, and then lastly, FOSS for startups. I think that's the point of this entire seminar today. Looking at FOSS for startups, and that's what I'll focus on towards the end. Now, I think everybody knows this, but I'm going to say it again. Anyway, just to make sure, as a good academic, that we have the definitions right. Open source, the phrase open source has different connotations for different people. And I do understand when I am in a conversation that people have a slightly different understanding of it than what perhaps I'm carrying with me. So I prefer to use the term FOSS, which is again used very widely. Sometimes in Europe it's also the term floss is used, not the floss that you use on your teeth, but the free libre and open source software. So the free part is very important and we have to keep it in there, and then of course the open source part. Now, how is FOSS defined? I would like to argue that it is defined in two possible ways. One is how it is made, and the other is how it is licensed. And these are both very important here, because they have an impact on the nature of what is called FOSS. How it is made is roughly the very famous distinction between the cathedral and the bazaar. The FOSS is made in the bazaar model. Large number of people around the world get together, collaborate. Ideally, that is how it is done. In fact, that is how a lot of it is still being done. However, now there is, of course, contributions from large corporate bodies who also participate in making FOSS software. The cathedral model, as I say, is the traditional punching bag of the FOSS community, which is the closed corporate model where everybody lives in one place. There is command and control, and everybody works for that one purpose of creating software. Whereas in the bazaar model, everybody participates freely and in their own capacities. So that's the difference in how it's made. The difference in licensing is, again, to simplify things, there are multiple licenses, as all of you would be aware, of what is called FOSS. The most famous one and the oldest one is known as the GPL, which defines what is called the freedoms of software. And here typically you refer to those four freedoms in software. This was created by Richard Stallman almost 34 years ago. And it has defined in many ways what is called the free software movement. There are many variations of this software, and I think Mishi may bring up some of those. Those may come up as questions, very valid questions. Now, typically, proprietary software, which is the opposition to this, and we, in academics too, we like to see, understand things in what is its, what it is not. What it is it gives you these four freedoms. What it is not is proprietary software, which does not give you these four freedoms. Proprietary software typically may give you one of them, which is to use the software, but it may not give you the others to modify, distribute, and so on. And that's the distinction we work with. Now, before I go into FOSS economics, you know, when I started working here 12 years ago, I used to go to my classes, and you know, we have very bright students, and I would tell them, you know, free software is the way to go, and I would have a very hard time convincing anybody. I would get a lot of flack from my students saying, no, we don't know what this stuff is. you know, who makes it, who ensures it's good enough. But today, I think I can safely say that we can declare victory. This is we can sort of plant the flag and say we have won. The most of the software around the world, I will argue, perhaps not with much evidence, but I will still argue it because I've read it in various places. Most of the software in the world is of the nature of free and open source software. Most of the software that is running all the hundreds of devices we all have. Also, convincing people now anymore is not an issue. I do not have to go into an audience and including my students and tell them what about FOSS. Everybody knows what it is. Everybody is using it in some form or another, and that war has been won. What else has happened? So there's this very interesting book by Benkler, which I recommend to you, which is also available for free, incidentally, as a free download, who talks about what the impacts of FOSS are. And these are some points I've pulled out from the book, which are very valuable for us, and this is how it drives our thinking. First, the final product is non-proprietary. What that means is, in some sense, nobody has strict ownership over it. So if you take something like Linux, sure, Linux may have some copyright holders who have written the code, but actually Linux is available for all of us to use. We are running this presentation on Linux right now. We were running Windows, we had to remove the laptop and bring it in. I wanted to make sure we at least give the right signals here today. So anybody can use Linux, it's not proprietary in that sense. There is a strict legal meaning of proprietary also, which I'm going to safely leave to my legal colleague to deal with. There is no price signaling in the market. This is a very critical issue. Price for us signaling means it is usually an indicator of quality amongst other things. And if something comes at zero price, we may, in normal terms, we tend to think it's probably junk. It's probably no good. After all, the difference between a Mercedes and a Maruti is in multiple lakhs, and you always believe that the Mercedes is better. That price signaling has actually affected the adoption rates of free software significantly, and it has had other impacts also. There is no central command and control of this production. So this is not in the cathedral model, so there is no manager and there are no series of a hierarchy of people who are dictating requirements. It's pretty much what you think is worthwhile you build. Now that is in theory. There are complications here also. If one looks closely at the free software community, there is some amount of organization that is in there, but by and large there is no centralized command and control which you see in traditional production economies. Okay, no large inputs of capital required. Now what this basically means that if you don't have to set up a factory and buy a plant and go to Gujarat and open a huge facility, invest lakhs of rupees, this is made by people around the world who basically need a computer and an internet connection, and they're in business. You can create this software. It relies heavily, as can be understood, on distributed computing facilities and networks, and as we all know, this whole movement took off after the internet became widely available. Now, this is another very important point that Benkler makes. This is the famous feedback loop. Many of us are probably engineers and we would have seen this. This is a feedback loop of information goods. What happens here is when people put in and make, for instance, free software, FOSS software, and it is used by others, what it does is it acts as a lever. It goes back and feeds back. It acts as a lever to create more and more further goods. So if we go back to the early days of free software, it was pretty much Stallman who was making a lot of tools, and he made a huge slew of them, which then later on were used by a large number of people to build something like Linux and other software which are widely used. So this feedback loop is a virtuous cycle, and it has very strong implications for our this loop has very strong implications for an economy where the virtuous cycle of creating software goods, information goods, goes back in creating more information goods, which are create further value. Now, I keep using the word information good or the phrase information good. What does it finally mean? It has certain properties. Information goods, I'll rattle them off. This is textbook stuff. They have high initial costs of production, but marginal costs of reproducing them is very little. So it takes a lot of money to make the first software, but copying it is zero. So which is why you have a lot of the things that are happening on the internet nowadays. There is very easy versioning possible of these kind of information goods. And this is true for all information goods, regardless of open source or proprietary. That's not the case. Then you have a situation where you can, I talked about copying, versioning, and this whole difference between the original and the copy, that also disappears. These properties impact how these goods are finally used over in the economy and over a period of time. Now, what does it do? Low cost of final product means it enables innovation. Many states in Kerala, in fact many countries around the world, governments in Brazil in particular, Argentina, Cuba, and others, even in China, the governments have taken a stand saying free software should be either made compulsory or it should be made as a strong choice for use across the economy. Why? Because if you have access, easy access to goods, it promotes innovation. In a state like Kerala, this is happening very significantly. Again, please note, I'm not saying that having proprietary software won't have innovation. It's just that free software, because of the easier access, it makes things different. For the Indian economy, and this argument holds, this is very, very valuable. I have done work on this. It's available on my site on how it promotes entrepreneurship and innovation in a big way. In fact, I did a study, and I'm going to show you some of the results of that study. I looked at 20 startups in India who have based their businesses on open source, and have done very well. So here is my mind map for what I will do further. I'm going to go into some technical issues here. I don't want to dwell on them too much. I'll go through the broad ideas. So looking at FOSS for startups, the key issue I'm looking at here is competition. So when you are in a competitive market, you want to run a business, how can you leverage FOSS to play this competitive game? So we are existing in a hyper-competitive environment. And there's this famous economist, Schumpeter, who's is quoted very often about something called creative destruction. Basically, you have market disruptions which are happening, and technology does this in a big way. So suddenly, entire organizations completely disappear, entire technologies disappear because something new has come up and the entire market shifts. Now, basically, today, and I will say this very strongly, IT, information technology, is the biggest disruptor going, very big disruptor. So we see entire industries disappearing completely. To give an example, the music industry as we used to know it is practically gone, or it's going away very fast. In fact, news media and books will probably follow very soon. This is massive disruption. This is disruption at an economy industry scale, which is huge. It takes time, but because of IT, it has tremendous impacts. If you are a player, if you are a startup and innovator in this space, in this hyper-competitive space, what you need is agility and flexibility. And this, anybody who's worked in the startup space in IT knows, you've got to move fast. You have to identify those things called imperfections in markets, those little places that you have to go and fill in the niche. These are also called opportunities that you find. You have to assemble what we are calling dynamic capabilities. This is a theory here. Your capabilities have to be such that they evolve over time. You have to sense and respond to the market, and you have to have these continuous entrepreneurial actions which make you move. typically what happens in IT, and this is also true, the threat is that if you can do something quickly, well, probably so can two other people who also have the same skills as you have. And that is what is the fight all about. And if you can move fast enough and grab that market, that makes sense for you. Now, what does IT do? It helps you bridge that knowledge gap that there is. You learn things, you create assets, and you deploy them fast enough so that you co-evolve your business with the IT. Now, I know this is high theory here, and I would need to explain this a lot more, but stay with me. Look at the last bullet point there. This has to do with entrepreneurial agility, to move fast, and to respond to the market. So if you have a cloud-based startup which is doing something good, and there are many, many cloud-based startups in this city, you not only have to provide a niche product which somebody will want, you have to move with it. You have to respond to the market, because this cloud market is evolving very rapidly and changing very fast. That's the point here, and IT lets you do that. Now, why is FOSS interesting here? FOSS is interesting, it's because it's one of the largest reuse repositories anywhere on the planet. And of course, it's completely freely available. So you want something, you go to any one of these great resources, go to GitHub or go to SourceForge and look around, you'll probably find it, whatever you want. Now, that's the good news. The bad news here, the challenge is that FOSS was not designed for reuse. The FOSS programmers around the world like to make stuff. They don't want to write code for it, and or rather write documentation for it so that other people will know what they are doing exactly and find it. And that has remained a consistent challenge throughout. How do I find what I want to do in this, you know, humongous amount of code that is available? I want to write a small driver for some device I have. Where do I find it? And Google search is not helping me. Those become challenges, and of course people are addressing those challenges, but that's one of the issues here. FOSS, why is it helpful for dynamic market capabilities? One of the things I mentioned is that I surveyed did case studies on 20 entrepreneurs, businesses, and I'll mention some names. Just Dial is one of them, which Clear Trip is another one, which use FOSS in a big way, and who have built their businesses around FOSS. Some examples I have on the slide are why they chose FOSS. We asked them, and the answers came out very clearly. You have issues of performance, you have issues of scalability, you have stability, points of failure, security threats. All these came up repeatedly. So one of the firms said very clearly, look, I had to come up with a solution which had a requirement, and this is Just Dial I'm talking about. Just Dial, if you're familiar with this company, I think most of you will be familiar, you can call them or you can go to their website, and they tell you what's a local business. And they have this very clear requirement that they have to give you the answer in less than 60 seconds, because nobody waits more than that. So they have to go through this database, find where you are, if you are calling them from a mobile phone, and find out that pizza shop you want nearby you in less than 60 seconds. You won't wait more than that. How did they optimize this? They optimized this, they said, clearly with free software. They took some tools, components, put them together, built it up so that they could get that response. Of course, there is cost savings. I don't dwell on this too much. Of course, if there are questions, I can go into this. There are huge implications for the return on investment for the FOSS deployment. So agility, flexibility, and develop the entrepreneurial spirit. One of the key issues in FOSS, and I'm going to stop here with this, is because of the nature of FOSS, which is the source code is available to you, you have the ability legally to change that, to change the source code, you have the ability to deploy it the way you like, gives you immense freedom to actually participate as an entrepreneur, to think of new things, to build things. And this is happening across the globe. I was just discussing with my colleagues here about this, you may have read about this young girl in Kashmir Valley who decided to make an Android app. And why? One of the reasons she could do this is that she had the tools available and she learned how to use them on the internet. So that's the other side of the story, that the knowledge is also becoming free. But once the tools are available, people feel empowered and they can do things.